Hello and welcome to Candela. This lecture is about one fossil primate, the Heidelberg jaw or the Mauer jaw. There are many things interesting about this fossil, as it exhibits both human-like as well as ape-like characters. This created large-scale speculation, and our paleontologists found it very difficult to give a phylogenetic position for this fossil. In this lecture, let us discuss the discovery of the fossil, its description, in which we will discuss about its anatomical features, and then the phylogenetic position of this fossil. First, let us discuss about the discovery of this fossil. In the year 1707, Daniel Hartmann, he was a mine worker. It is he who discovered this fossil at a place called as Mauer, which lies to the south of Heidelberg in Germany. That's why we call this as Heidelberg jaw or the Mauer jaw. But how it is possible for a mine worker to discover a fossil? He is not a paleontologist. Mr. Otto Schottenstock, he was a great paleontologist, and he was working in this region for the past 20 years. Earlier in the year 1887, Schottenstock discovered a fossil of one elephant skull along with its tusk. This created large scale enthusiasm and large scale optimism. He thought that yes, this Mauer sounds right, it should be a source for some other our human fossils also. So what he did, he advised the mine workers to look for any fossil when they were mining that area. And the mine workers that they have discovered number of fossils like elephants, rhinoceros, etc. On one fine day in the year 1907, the mine worker Daniel Hartmann, he discovered a fossil. He discovered this jaw. When he discovered this jaw was broken into two pieces, but good, it was still intact. But there were some portions in the left side of the jaw which went missing, and we couldn't trace it until now. Then almost every single teeth, almost all the teeth were intact, but only two premolars in the left side were missing. So apart from that, this was a big discovery. Then he took it to Schottenstock. Schottenstock studied this fossil for 1 year, and in the year 1908, he published a paper in which he named this fossil as Homo heidelbergensis, and he described its anatomical features. So there are number of contrasting features in this fossil, and recently the radiocarbon dating had found its year, or found this fossil is 640,000 years old. That means this fossil belongs to the middle Pleistocene period. That's why in the latter half of the 20th century, most of the fossils discovered from Europe during this middle Pleistocene period, they are grouped into this category of Homo heidelbergensis, that we will discuss later. This fossil is roughly 640,000 years old. That means this occupies the middle Pleistocene period. Then Schottenstock, by studying the wearing pattern of the molar, he found that there is only a very less wearing pattern in this molar. That means this jaw should belong to an young adult. So he came to a conclusion that this jaw, right, it should belong to some young adult who is between 20 to 30 years old. There are few characters in the Mauer jaw which are truly human. For example, the teeth of Heidelberg jaw is truly human, but the jaw exhibits a number of primitive features. Now let us discuss the primitive features in the Mavur jaw. As I told you, the teeth are perfectly human, but the jaw is very much primitive. The jaw exhibits a number of simian characters. So before discussing the actual primitiveness in this jaw, let us discuss few anatomical terms. For example, I have mentioned here condyloid process and coronoid process. Mandibular notch or sigmoid notch, truncated symphysis. So let us discuss what these things are. So I have mentioned as condyloid process, coronoid process. In anatomy, if you say process, process refers to an extension of a tissue or a bone from a larger mass. That we call it as a process. Then condyloid, if you say condyle, condyle refers to that one portion or one end of a bone which is rounded and which forms an articulation with the other bone. For example, here we have a ball and socket joint. So this particular bone, right, this anterior end of or the one end of this bone will have a rounded structure which forms an articulation with our shoulder bone. That portion is called as a condyle. Here we have number of condyles. In femur bone, we have one condyle. Okay. So condyle means that is that portion of that one end of a bone which forms an articulation surface with the another bone so that we can move our arms or that part. So by condyloid process, we refers to this particular portion. I'll just tell you what is a condyloid process. Then coronoid process. So now, are you okay with the term process? Process means that refers to that portion of a tissue or a bone which extends from a larger mass. This is our Mavur jaw and that is our human jaw. See here, this portion, this is a condyloid process and this is a coronoid process. As I told you, process means that is that portion of a bone or a tissue which extends from a larger mass. See, this portion and this portion, it extends from the larger mass, right? That's why we call this as a coronoid process. Coronoid literally means crown like. It is like a crown, right? It is like a crown. This is coronoid process and this is condyloid process. So condyle means that forms an articulation area with another bone. So it is this portion, right, which gets attached to our cranium. So this is the condyloid process, this is the coronoid process, and the depression between this condyloid process and the coronoid process, this depression, this shallow depression is called as the sigmoid notch or the mandibular notch. And this portion of our lower jaw is called as the ascending rami. Rami is plural, ramus is singular. We call it as ascending ramus. Ascending ramus. Okay. And this anterior portion, this region, we call it as the symphysis of the jaw. Symphysis means that is the region where the left side of the jaw and the right side of the jaw fuses. That portion we call it as the symphysis of a jaw. So now let us compare, now let us see the primitive features found in the jaw by comparing this two. See, in a human jaw, coronoid process lies slightly at a higher elevation when compared to the condyloid process. That means condyloid process lies slightly lower when compared to the coronoid process. But here in our Mavur jaw, that is not the case. Here, the coronoid process is slightly at a lower side when compared to the condyloid process. Then the sigmoid notch, you see the sigmoid notch, the sigmoid or the mandibular notch here is very shallow. it is very shallow. For human beings, it used to be like this. It is very shallow. Again, this is one primitive feature of this jaw. Then, see the thickness of the rami. The anterior-posterior side, anterior-posterior, this is anterior, this is posterior. The anterior-posterior length of this rami. It is, see it is very broad here. It is almost like a square. But here it is not so broad. Then, absence of the chin is a very prominent primitive feature of the Heidelberg jaw. For most of the genus Homo, chin is very prominent. So, see here, chin is absent. But here, chin is present in modern human beings. Even for Homo erectus, chin is very, very prominent. Even for Neanderthals, chin is very prominent. But for this fossil, chin is totally absent, and even the thickness of the mandible is a bit more when compared to that of human mandible. Along with that, this symphysis, there is some portion of this jaw which is broken here. But still, the symphysis is very clear, and the symphysis of this jaw is truncated. See, the symphysial stress is the characteristic of most of the primate jaw, and which is found even here. So that is a primitive feature found in this Maurer jaw. So now let us discuss these things one after another again. As I mentioned, the primitive characteristics of the Maurer jaw. Thickness of the mandible. The mandible is very thick. The mandible is very thick. Then the ramus. I told you this is the ascending ramus. The anterior posterior side of this ramus is very broad. Is very broad. Then this is condyloid process, and this is coronoid process. In human beings, the coronoid process lies like this. The coronoid process will be like this. But here, the coronoid process is so blunt here. It is so blunt. As a result, even the sigmoid notch is very, very shallow. Very shallow. Then see here, there are lot of space in the lower jaw. Even there is a comfortable space for one wisdom teeth to develop here. But no, the teeth are perfectly human-like. So this gives a look as if this is a jaw of a gibbon. And see one more thing, absence of chin. As I told you, absence of chin is a very prominent primitive feature of this jaw. Even for Homo erectus, even for Neanderthals, jaw is prominently present. Then, as I told you, the symphysis region here, that is where the left side and the right side of the jaw fuses, that symphysis is truncated. So, these are the very primitive characters of this jaw. Otherwise, right, the teeth are perfectly human. So, how come it is possible for such a primitive jaw to have a human-like teeth? And our bad luck, we couldn't find, our paleontologist couldn't find any similar fossils in that region. This was the only available jaw. Now let us discuss the phylogenetic position of Heidelberg jaw. Schoetenschenk, he was the first to study the fossil. He found that there is a combination of human-like as well as ape-like characters. The teeth are perfectly human, so he preferred to keep this fossil in our genus Homo. He named it as Homo heidelbergensis. Later, Professor Harlika and Wettenreich, they were studying Java man and Peking man. It was then Eugene Dubois discovered the great Pithecanthropus erectus, and W.C. Pei discovered Sinanthropus pekinensis, the so-called Java man and Peking man. Vedantris, he was studying those fossils and he found that both the fossils belong to one species, that is Homo erectus. So then it was a time when he also, after studying our Heidelbergia, Harlequin, Vedantris, they came to a conclusion that this fossil should be the European version of, or the European form of Homo erectus. So it was during this time the out of Africa theory was becoming popular, and Professor Vedantris, he found that as an opportunity to explain or to infer that Homo heidelbergensis is the European form of Homo erectus. But after that, there were number of studies and analysis about the fossil, and finally, of late, Stringer and Reitmer, they gave one conclusion that Homo heidelbergensis might have been the last common ancestor for both Neanderthals as well as our modern Homo sapiens. But still, this speculation continues, and we are yet to conclude that what exactly the species is. And there are a number of unanswered questions here. For most importantly, is it right to give a species status to this jaw? This jaw. That means we are able to find only one jaw, and is it right to give a species status to this jaw? Next is, see, we are saying that Homo heidelbergensis is the ancestor for human beings. If that is the case, then who is the ancestor for this heidelbergensis? That we couldn't answer. So unless or until there were many such similar discoveries, we cannot conclude. Until then, we'll continue to speculate what this species. Hope now you have a good understanding about Homo heidelbergensis. For more such video, subscribe to our channel or log on to www.candelacn.com. Thank you.